this is actually where you got the name from for the band?
Yeah, we didn't name ourselves after the sculpture. We just liked the name.
Is there any Seattle scene?
This was the scene. We'd go and see the shows that were put on by the U-Man, and we'd go see these guys, and these guys would come see us. And everyone would go see these guys.
Sometimes we would open for these guys, so it was like, oh, sweet play, and then these guys would come out.
It's not like it's this magical bottomless pit of great bands or anything. I mean, there's plenty of bad bands coming out of Seattle, too.
There's so much media attention on it that they're expecting all this great stuff to keep flourishing from Seattle, and it's probably, you know, had its day.
Yeah, I'm sure eventually, if you say you're a band from Seattle, people will be less likely to want to hear about you than more likely.
It's trendy now, which is a really bad thing to be from Seattle, you know.
Yeah, if you're going to be in fashion, at one point you're going to be out of fashion at another point. There was no pressure put on us by the label to do anything or write any particular kind of record. Both Louder Than Love and Bad Motorfinger, and even Temple of the Dog for that matter, were all records made by us, you know, with no one, you know, trying to impress upon us any guidelines other than us. We didn't come out with like an incredibly commercial record and then go out and tour with Guns N' Roses. You know, we came out with our record as it is, which isn't a commercial record, and toured with a band like that. And I think that people know, as long as you're doing what you want to do, that who you're playing in front of and who you're playing with isn't as important. And to us, I mean, considering how much we've toured and how long we've been a band, it was important to us to do something different and play in front of new people.
We came out of like an urban scene that bands like Pearl Jam, Mudhoney, and the Melvins, and Nirvana all came out of, which was sort of like this small town kind of urban club scene that was also just as much of a recording scene as anything. It wasn't a vibrant club scene. It was, you could play shows here and there, but for the most part, we were bands that recorded and made demos and independent records.
Is there a feeling about which bands would maybe break through first or not?
And it would depend on who you were a fan of, because in spite of the reputation of like what it is, all of the bands have very different sounds. You know, they're very different bands. There's certain similarities, but really, I mean, if you sat down someone who didn't know and played them a Nirvana record, a Mudhoney record, and a Soundgarden record, and a Pearl Jam record, they would have no clue that they were all from like the same city or the same scene.
Being nominated for a Grammy, I don't think it's going to affect us in the slightest bit.
Yeah, I think the first sign you'll see of that is when we all start getting facial reconstructive surgery. You know, when we come out.
I don't feel I've changed at all.
I'm in the Chaplin screening room on the A&M lot with my friends.
Kim File from Soundgarden, also in the Chaplin screening room on the A&M lot.
Matt Cameron.
And Ben Shepherd.
They're hanging here with us.
It's in the Chaplin screening room on the A&M lot.
This song got a new album. I guess you recorded up north of Seattle, again with Terry Day. Has Terry sort of become like the fifth member of the band?
No, he's the producer. He's been on he's done two records with us at this point.
I mean, is he pretty involved in putting music together in the studio, or he just puts it down to tape?
He records it. And
down to tape guy.
Yeah, he's like co-producer pretty much. I mean, that's the way he likes to work usually with bands, and that's the way he works with us or has worked with us. I mean, the fact that we used him on our last record and this record doesn't mean we'll use him on every record we ever make or anything.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. But when you went up north to Seattle, were you staying at the studio? I mean, were you sort of isolated?
No, we lived up in Seattle, so we were staying at home and then commuting.
Okay. How set were the arrangements then when you go in to record? I mean, are you pretty much got everything ready?
Yeah,
to go?
We're rehearsing them. You're playing the whole song in rehearsal. They're all ready to go live.
Sometimes songs get rearranged in the studio. We usually write songs right up to the point that we record, and sometimes it'll be like something that just isn't washing, and all of a sudden we'll change it at the last minute, you know, and then record it, and it works.
We're definitely playing it as a band before we're recording it.
We always are looking for
sort of capturing what we would sound like live on tape. You know, I think that's what most most rock bands try for, and it's probably most rock bands' biggest problem when it comes to recording a record.
On your third bassist now, we ask, why did Jason leave?
And the flavor is still lasting. We asked Jason to leave because we didn't. We've been used to a situation where everyone in the band were friends, you know, before the band was started, and everyone got along, and everyone sort of could relate to each other on a friendly level and like a, you know, a natural level where he didn't really have to struggle to get along. And when Hero left, it was sort of difficult to try and find somebody that could not only be in your band as a player, but also be your friend and like actually get along with them as a person and a human being and relate to them, you know, and you know, enough ways, you have enough things in common that you can be buddies. And that's, for us, it's not that easy to do, really. I mean, we don't have a lot of friends. We're fairly reclusive. We don't, you know, we're not social butterflies. And with Jason, that just didn't click. And with Ben, you know, when we asked Jason to leave, we didn't do a big casting call and run people through auditions again. We chose Ben sort of simultaneously.
We kind of knew that Ben had no friends.
Yeah.
So you let him in the club.
And I knew that every garden needs a beanpole. Look how skinny I am.
You see how skinny I am?
He's skinny.
I'd like to not have any sexual impulses and not have to sleep.
That'd be great.
Because that would save like a lot of time and like it would save a lot of energy spent on things that aren't as important
man.
As other things. Yeah, like guarding a bridge. No, you know, like things I'd rather do, like writing music and playing music and hiding from the rest of the world. That would be fun. That would
you
be
find you think about sex a lot?
Yeah, all the time.
Enough
every day.
To distract you.
Which is really irritating. It's distracting. It also makes people like totally compromise their judgment and do like really stupid things. Mm-hmm. And it's a battle to not do that, not let that happen.
Isn't that sort of fun in a way as well?
I guess not. It's flattering to be influential, but you know, it's like if you go to the store and you buy a really nice dress, and then you go to a party and some other bitch is wearing your dress. Even though you might like her, maybe she was your old roommate or something, but it's still, you know, you wish you wouldn't wear it because you bought it first.
Here at Foundations Forum 91, I'm Ricky Rackman. This is the Headbangers Ball, and these guys are Soundgarden. That's the new bass player, Ben. And heard rumors, something that I'm crossing my fingers for. I hear about a possible tour with you guys and...
Guns N' Roses.
Yes.
So this is happening.
Seems to be.
It's got to be pretty exciting for you. I mean, it's a pretty big band, and getting you guys out in front of even a bigger market.
Definitely.
I mean, yeah. Now you guys started off with kind of an alternative bass, right? People that were listening to you, and now it's crossing over into the rock and roll audience. Is that right?
That's true, actually. But even from early on, I think we had what you might call alternative hard rock fans. You know, we're certainly no mainstream band by any stretch. You know, we don't have a.
We have had mainstream fans, though.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. That's true. But. Like a tour with like Guns N' Roses, it would be a good tour whether it was arenas or not, just because, you know, you're dealing with a band that has a metal following but isn't heavy metal, you know, and appeals to more than just like one genre of music, and there isn't really too many bands out there like that. We've always had sort of a problem with tour packages because we're not an easy band to like put with another band.
Now, I think you did a little bit of acting recently for this movie, Singles. Aren't you in that movie?
I did some cameos in it. It doesn't really involve much acting, you know. I just sort of be myself.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. So. Now tell us a little bit about the video, which we're about to debut here.
Well, we crucify meat and women and plants and
a salad,
birds and rocks and things.
We crucify a salad.
Now, that's drawing the line. I'm sorry. When you're innocent vegetables, I don't know. That's kind of a little bit too much.
We knew we'd offend somebody.
You see,
I was the one that you offended with the vegetables.
we're glorifying the vegetables by like putting them, you know, on the cross like a deity, you know. It's like a religion of vegetables now.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a look at the brand new video from them. This is a debut. This is Jesus Christ Pose from Soundgarden.
Don't be scared.
Now, recently we caught up with Chris Cornell from Soundgarden to ask him about, you know, there's been a little bit of controversy about the imagery in his new video, Jesus Christ Pose, and this is what he said.
The whole idea behind the song initially was me personally being irritated by the exploitation of the Christ Pose persecuted deity figure. You know, you see it in rock magazines and fashion magazines where you see rock stars and models like assuming that pose, and how it was kind of irritating, and basically I'm sort of exploiting it to show that it's irritating to exploit it in the video. It's probably one of the most widely seen images in the Western world, and we just kind of are making it a little bit more wider. So.
That was Chris Cornell from the band Soundgarden. Soundgarden is one of the bands that has a new album out, which is incidentally called Bad Motorfinger, which has also got a good street buzz. I was talking a little bit earlier when Nirvana was here. A lot of people are getting into Nirvana. A lot of people are really getting into the new Soundgarden album, and that's purely because it's very good. Welcome back to the Headbangers Ball. I'm here with Chris and Kim from the band Soundgarden. Welcome back to the show.
And thank
guys,
you.
We're here a long, long time ago when I was just starting out, and then we talked to you at the Concrete Foundations.
Mm-hmm.
And for those people that missed the show then, you guys have a new member of the band.
Yeah, Ben Shepherd, the bass player.
And tell us a little bit about that and how that came about. For those that missed that show.
We pretty much hired him because he was 6'3", 6'4".
Yeah, no, you know, people don't harass us as much with that guy.
So it was kind of the fear factor that you put him in there.
Yeah, he's the type of person who would like kick your ass and then read you poetry afterwards.
Now, mm-hmm. he played on the new album, right?
Yeah. He wrote on the new album too.
So did things seem a lot different having a new member contributing to a band?
It always probably should, unless it's like a situation where you're just hiring a guy just to do what you tell him to do. But we definitely wanted somebody to contribute, because we've always been used to having like four members contributing musically to what we're doing. Mm-hmm. We're just used to it. We like it. It's the way it should be.
I like the record a lot. I've been listening to it a real lot, and it seems to me that a lot of maybe radio stations, a lot of people have been playing the song Outshined a lot.
Yeah, it seems like they have.
Is it possible that that's going to be a new single and video?
We're going to do a video for that today.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Any, give us some like kind of hints, because I know we're going to have it on the Headbangers Ball. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about what it's going to be like before we see it.
Yeah, all I can really say is that I have no idea.
Because you don't
about
have
as specific as I can get.
You don't go into it with a certain idea of how you want to do it?
Yeah, we always do, and then it never comes out that way. So, you know, we'll come back and let you know.
That's a question. This might be a dumb question, but it wouldn't be the first time I asked one. Slaves and Bulldozers mm-hmm. is my favorite song on the record. And are you doing all the vocals in that? Because there's one part where if it is your voice, it sounds real low and it sounds like somebody else.
It's me.
Oh.
It's okay. A trick.
Very, very cool song. Which songs to you guys stand out on the album?
Slaves and Bulldozers stands out quite a bit.
Very, definitely. It's a powerful, grooving, hard song.
Yeah, a lot of people seem to like that one.
Yeah, I always think of our albums more in terms of albums as opposed to like picking out songs. It always seems like what we shoot for is an hour of music as opposed to a couple of lead tracks and then a B-side, you know?
Kind of the thing you just put on and listen to the whole thing.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's 12 singles on one disc.
Harry, it's a greatest hits album, all in one.
It's the heavy metal white album.
Now, it's definitely a powerful album. I mean, you guys play with a lot of emotion. How could you say this differed from the last Soundgarden record?
Oh, the last record was the alternative college rock white album.
See, that's what people are saying. People are saying, oh, Soundgarden's an alternative band. And Soundgarden's
aren't
this.
We?
And with this, you guys, I've heard that. Oh, I don't. Okay, I try not to label bands at all, but you can't help but hear them sometimes. But this is definitely a rock and roll record. I
mean, yeah,
it's heavy.
Yeah.
And you guys are going to be going on the road pretty soon with this, right?
We sure are. We'll
talk about that a little bit later when we return with Soundgarden. But right now it's time for Skull Crusher number 3, Motley Crue doing an old Pistols classic, Anarchy in the UK. Back with Chris and Kim from the band Soundgarden on the Headbangers Ball. And look, People Magazine. Not only will you find out about Chris Efford's baby, but you will also hear see a Soundgarden review, read about a Soundgarden review, and they even give you guys a good review. Now, With this album, I mean, obviously the album's doing good.
Yeah,
so
really well.
You guys are getting a much larger Soundgarden fan base.
Yeah, we're getting a larger audience.
Did I say lard?
All yes. Our fans were skinny, but now we got this, you know. These big guys coming to the shows and girls.
That's right. So it's not just more fans at the show; just they're much it's larger. Fatter, yeah. So it just looks like they take up more.
It's space. A larger audience.
Well, how it works is you have a delicious shake for breakfast, another one for lunch, and then you go see a Soundgarden show, and then have a sensible dinner.
And that's what it is. But the Soundgarden, it burns calories though.
We do.
Shows.
We do.
Now, in order for you to get,
we tend to feed the fans,
and then they stick their bad motor finger down
lunch
their throat.
For everyone.
That's how it works. Yeah. Now, are you seeing a big cross section of Soundgarden fans now? Like the old time Soundgarden fans, and can you say, oh, these people are obviously just gotten into the band because of Bad Motorfinger?
I hate to say it, but yeah, you can tell.
You can?
Oh, no, I can't. Okay. All the new Soundgarden fans are covered in invisible ink. They look like the old Soundgarden fans.
Yeah. That's how it works. Well, thanks again for stopping by. Look for them, obviously, when they play with Guns N' Roses. I recommend this album. Go check it out. Thanks again for stopping by.
Yes, the Headbangers Ball is coming to you from Prague on the Guns N' Roses tour, and Guns will be back a little later on. But right now, I'm joined by Soundgarden. Welcome back to MTV and Prague. How are you doing?
Well, we've never been to Prague before, but it's nice to be back to MTV.
Oh, thank you. Now, you guys have recently completed a tour stateside with Monster Magnet and Swerve Driver, which sounds a pretty interesting lineup. How did that work out?
It worked out really great. We had fun. We got along with each other.
What are you most looking forward to about this tour with Guns?
It's catering.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Is it difficult for you to adjust from like playing clubs and then back to stadiums and back
well,
to clubs?
We'll see after tonight, won't we? We'll find out, see how it goes.
Okay.
It sure keeps it from being boring though, you know,
that's
switching.
True. Now I've heard rumors of a possible live EP or something. Is that, have I heard correctly?
No, we did kind of a, sort of a, I guess you could call it fairly live recording of some songs at home a few months ago that are going to be released, but it's not really a live recording. It's just like we didn't spend any time on it. We spent like, you know, one day recording a bunch of songs, and we did it for B-sides, for singles and things, and I got a good response from it, so we decided to make a limited edition EP. It'll be in the States, it'll be sold free basically with the copy of the record, and I don't know if it will be released over here, you know, if it is, I don't know what way.
Cool. And what about video? Are you going to be ever releasing like a home video or anything like that?
Well, in the States we just released Rusty Cage as a video in the US.
I mean, you know, yeah.
Yeah, okay, yeah. We did that too. We recorded ourselves live two nights at the Paramount in Seattle, and I think they're working on editing and putting that together, so yeah, we'll see that.
Is that going to be available to the fans in Europe?
No, we specifically requested they don't sell it in Europe. It's only for Americans.
Well, I think that we will have to get one of these clips off you guys when it's available and show you guys live in action.
Okay.
Okay. So thanks very much for joining me again. It's nice to see you.
All right.
And best of luck.
It's good to be seen.
Best of luck on tour with Guns N' Roses.
Okay.
Skupina Soundgarden je nejméně známá z té trojice Guns N' Roses, Faith No More. Are you feel like stars now?
No.
No?
No.
And are you working for to be star? Are well, you going to be?
No, only true stars are like dead
Ursa
rock
Minor.
Musicians, various constellations.
We want to be wizards.
Okay. And do you think that Faith No More, for example, they are?
Not really. Maybe. I don't know.
Just the bass player, Billy. He's a true star.
Really? You mean it seriously?
No, I'm actually being quite sarcastic.
About your music, Sensei.
Yeah, could you do that?
We came up with a pretty good definition yesterday. It was a early 70s U.S. muscle car driving through the prom. Not to the prom, but right through the dance floor of the prom. So it is.
And your tonight show will be really loud?
Yeah.
Much more loud than other two bands?
Oh, no.
No, it won't,
no.
Be,
it won't be as loud.
No. They usually, the way they set it up, they usually don't allow the first band to be louder than the headliner.
Yeah. It's a rule.
It's
when you're stars.
It's etiquette in touring, at least the U.S. and parts of Europe.
Okay. And we know that you are a big friend with Faith No More. Can you say how was built the friendship?
We were mutual fans, I guess, of each other's bands. We played a show together by chance, and we liked each other's bands, and eventually toured together in the States. Just became friends that way.
Okay, and how you will feel in biggest stadium in the world tonight?
Is this really the biggest stadium?
It's the biggest, yeah, but
about the big ones in Sao Paulo or Rio?
Yeah, it's really biggest. Really? They said.
Oh. We'll feel small like ants.
Yeah, everyone should get their opera glasses if you're in the back row so you can watch us. Those opera visors.
But you're looking forward.
Oh, yeah.
What are we looking forward?
So, yeah. Oh, what are we looking for?
I suppose doing the tour, selling a bunch of records, and going home.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Hello. Okay. Hi, Chris.
Hi.
This is kind of a wet set, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Does it make your set different when the audience is wet, when the weather is awful, when there's thunder and lightning?
I think the lightning was kind of cool, but other than that, it was the same as a big normal rock show with the stage lights coming from God, I guess.
Yeah. Now tell me, Chris, the noise that you make, or is noise the wrong word? The noise that you make does fit to this weather.
Yeah, I think so. I think noise is the perfect word.
Now, what do you want to reach with this noise? Do you want to spread aggression?
No, not really. Just want to make some sounds that maybe people might not hear the rest of the day.
What is so attractive to making this sound?
It's fun. It's like a little kid with a really big toy.
Okay, it's fun, but it's so loud.
Why are you saying you don't like it?
Yeah, well, I like it.
No, come on, don't.
He's lying to you, people. He's lying.
Well, no. I like some parts of it, but it's so loud all over. It's constantly loud.
I know. Can you believe it?
Yeah. How difficult is it to put lyrics in a song like this?
It's easy. I mean, it's no different than putting lyrics over a soft song, really. You just take the mood of the music and write whatever inspires you first.
You don't mind the rain, do you?
No! No!
Oh, you know everybody on tour? Do you know most of the bands?
We're getting to know all the bands. We know like Pearl Jam and the Chili Peppers, Ministry guys are really cool. We're getting to know them.
We're really down with Ice Cube, and I guess we know everybody.
I figure you're winning over people all the time. This is a great opportunity.
We always win people over.
To steal an audience, maybe?
We're more likely to win someone over than disappoint them. I can disappoint him, but not Vancouver.
No.
Sorry. No. I missed you, Atlanta there.
You doing anything different? Have you shortened your set for this?
No, we lengthened it from the Guns tour where we were doing a half an hour, and now we're doing 45
minutes.
Yeah.
Okay. And do you get an encore?
No.
No, you're out of there. Do you get a sound check?
No,
we're out of there.
Do you get your catering?
Yes.
Does your rider still apply?
Yes.
No cigarettes.
But not all of it.
We get the beer and the water.
Is it decadence?
No
decadence.
Politically correct.
When you come back on your own, come back quietly, slip into town and play, will you?
Yeah, we will.
Thank you.
We'll slip it in quietly.
Thank you.
Did you get a chance to see any of the other bands play at all?
I've seen everybody except Lush so far.
Who's the best? Who did you like the best or something?
Soundgarden.
Who'd you like second best?
Soundgarden, I think, was good. They came in like a close second to us, but.
Welcome, guys. This is Soundgarden, and as you know, if you haven't seen the show yet, they're on Lollapalooza 92. It's okay. She's winking. They're on Lollapalooza 92 right now, and I got to see it Sunday and had a great time. Is it as much fun to like play and be a part of that whole traveling road show as it is to watch, would you assume?
It's much fun to make as it is to eat.
It's actually more fun because we get to be there every day, so, you know, we see the good shows and the bad shows and the weird things you don't expect.
So, yeah. in your show, one of the surprises I thought when I checked you out was that you play Cop Killer, the big controversial Ice-T song. Now, what's your take on that? You obviously feel something about it if you include it in your set.
Yeah, well, it was as simple as the idea that if for some reason, record companies or people who manipulate the media or people who try and influence it want there to be a situation where people can't decide what they will buy and what they will hear, you know, we'll take it upon ourselves to do what we can get away with and you know, spit it back in their face. And playing, you know, if playing the song every day, you know, helps do that, then that's a good enough reason to play it.
So that's kind of a controversial cover, but you also include covers from like Devo, Sabbath. There's what's your take on covers? Are there any targets in the future?
We have like a crystal ball, and we take the little thing off of it when we want to do a cover, and we just kind of look for it. And we're gonna do Hocus Pocus by Focus next, I think. That was the last one that came up, right? And we gotta stop using that thing. God.
So what? How about could you each tell us like a couple artists that you, Ben. Some artists that people would be surprised that Soundgarden likes. Like, is there like kind of a skeleton in your closet that you listen to?
No.
Like, do you dig ABBA or anything?
No, I don't.
I like Bjorn again.
Yeah, have you heard of them?
Yeah, English band.
They're an ABBA cover band.
Yeah, all they do is ABBA, which is amazing. There's a French guy that does all Tom Waits stuff in French, too, which is pretty amazing.
There's a girl over here who's kind of, she's wigging over here, and we're gonna have to get her a paramedic. We love you. But she had a question. It was a really good question. After the Temple of the Dog record and Andrew Wood's death, did it change how you saw, like, intake of, you know, drugs and alcohol and living the rock and roll life?
No, it's funny that you would ask that, though, because people have asked us that before. And Seattle was never that kind of city where it was like this drug-influenced rock culture of people like going to raves and getting really high. And it's always been more of a cynical kind of music culture. And that's, you know, that's one side of it, but it wasn't that sort of party atmosphere, drug use, you know. As far as that scene goes, it happens in every city and with every walk of life, from lawyers to doctors who abuse drugs more than almost anybody, as well as musicians, you know.
So, on Lollapalooza, who's like your favorite to watch? Do you stick around and check out the show?
Well, we do like the Jim Rose Circus Sideshow. It is fun.
Yeah.
And it makes people faint. I like to watch Pearl Jam a lot.
Mm-hmm. And if you could just like set the record straight, I saw you sing backup occasionally for Pearl Jam
sometimes,
for a tune. Kind of wander on back there. You don't like take the center stage, and then Eddie helps you guys out sometimes.
Right.
But is anybody here Temple of the Dog or not? Just let them know.
Oh, I couldn't tell you. I mean, we may do something from it at some point. We may not. We may just jam together as two bands. You never know. We haven't yet.
Okay.
But you know, that was like that album we did over a year ago, and honestly, I don't think we really remember how to play it. So.
Wow, well, everybody still really digs it. Definitely a great album, no matter when people discover it.
Ministry 2 is amazing to see on that tour. It's amazing.
Well, you guys are rocking yourselves, and we gotta go.
Thank you.
If you go to Lollapalooza, please check out Soundgarden.
Hi, and welcome back to the final part of tonight's show. Now, you know as well as I know that things are changing in the world of rock and roll. We're getting some great new bands coming through with a whole new attitude. And I think these two guys who are sitting next to me are very much a part of that. This is Chris Cornell and Matt Cameron from Soundgarden.
Hello.
It's nice to see you, chaps.
It's nice to see you.
Now, obviously, all of a sudden, the band has really broken big. I know that from what we were having a quick chat about earlier, you've been doing this for a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
Does it seem kind of strange that all of a sudden people are talking about Soundgarden as this new happening band?
Yeah, we get that a lot. Record after record, when you break into a new market, I mean, we may have been an alternative band for 5 or 6 or 7 years.
Before it was fashionable.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, all of a sudden, you know, a new medium sort of will embrace you and sort of say, here's a new band. And you kind of just have to bear with it because it is new to them.
There was too many
bad rock bands out there that were a little too popular. And there were some good trends, like Jane's Addiction getting real popular, and then Faith No More. And now, of course, you know, Nirvana getting real popular. It proves that there's a crowd out there that's into, you know, different styles instead of just what's shoved down their throat by radio and MTV.
You seem to think that the Seattle scene is starting to develop something of a tendency of what happened in LA in the past. Is that right?
Well, yeah.
There's sort of like a lot of people moving there from other cities in the U.S., you know, to start a band because there's so many bands that are successful out of there. And there's also like a lot of young bands starting out that are thinking about trying to get a record deal more than thinking about like trying to have fun playing music or writing songs, which seems like it'll eventually be the poison that'll kill the Seattle scene.
So what about Outshine, the new video, which we're just going to have a look at in a minute? I haven't actually seen it, I must confess, so you'll have to give me the big scoop on it.
Okay, I'll tell you what, it may be one of two versions that we made, because we made two different versions with two different directors, and I don't know which one you're going to show, and I know that you don't either, so...
So we're all in the dark here, and I'm pretty excited to find out what's going to happen. This is Soundgarden, and this is Outshine. Oh, it's been a pleasure talking to you anyway.
Thanks, man.
Great to have you down. Nice to see you, man.
Nice to see you.
Nice to see you, Chris.
You guys are watching the Pepsi Power 30. We have a very special guest today, guitarist Kemp Thayil from Soundgarden. You guys have taken a break from the Guns N' Roses tour, and you're playing in Toronto.
Yep, just a coffee break, though.
Just a little coffee break?
No, we're going back.
You're going back, and how's that going?
Going back?
No. How's the tour going?
Oh, it's going pretty well.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's a lot of fun. We're having a blast, believe it or not. Was that insincere? It was insincere, wasn't it? Having a blast.
Are the fans really up for the shows?
Yeah, they have to stand up because there are no chairs, so they're stage diving, running around. They're having, yeah.
Did you think when you went into this tour that you're going to encounter mostly Guns N' Roses fans?
Oh, we do encounter a few. I mean, there's definitely people, you know, off to the right, off to the left, you hear some boos and hisses, but they get drowned out really quickly by the people yelling.
And by the guitar, I'm sure.
Yeah, plus Ben and I and Chris tend to walk over to the wings of the stage and flip off the people booing. The next thing they do is light their lighter and applaud. I guess they need a little bit of abuse to
absolutely people
to
like
appreciate
abuse.
You.
Well, it didn't take too long for people to appreciate your videos. We're going to start off with your latest one, Outshine. Mm-hmm. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Let's see. It's called Outshine. The song is, I'm not really sure how long. I can't tell you anything about it. We did it in L.A. We recorded it. Well, something new. I wish I could say we recorded it in Peoria, but we didn't.
Are you happy with the video and the song, the way it's come out?
Can we go to a commercial?
Let's play Outshine on the Power 30. All right, you're back on the Power 30. Kemp Thayil, guitarist for Soundgarden, guest hosting the show today. Kemp, we're going to play your picks now, and you have decided on...
Hey, guys, you only let me play two picks.
Yeah, I know. It's the nature of the 30-minute show, you know?
That's right. Let's see. It's take up 15 minutes with only Soundgarden videos. And with these last two, I think we'll play some of our friends from Seattle. I don't know if they get played here much, but they will now.
And who are they?
Pearl Jam. They have a song out called Alive.
Yeah, we play them.
And Tad, Stumbling Man.
Okay, why did you pick these two?
Because they're from Seattle.
Because they're from Seattle? Yeah. A little bit of nepotism there.
Yeah, a bit of nepotism. It's like, they're not actually brothers, but because if they were, I wouldn't be able to marry them.
But they're friends, you guys
Yeah, we're
out?
Friends. Yeah, like I was telling
play
you,
tennis?
Play tennis together. Someone mentioned three-quarters court. Tad and I playing tennis. It's kind of like, I told you to hit it right there. I'm not chasing after it. You go get it.
Hey, Pearl Jam are real huge fans of Rush. How do you guys feel about them?
About
Rush?
Rush? Well, our drummer's, Neil Peart's definitely one of his inspirations. Rush was something, they're a great band. I listened to them when I was growing up. It's kind of forced upon me. All my friends would sit around and partake in, you know, sort of sit around with friends sort of things.
Partying.
Yeah, and then they'd listen to Rush.
So
2112.
So you can understand that then.
We used to do a Rush song. We used to do Working Man as a cover.
Do you ever do it anymore?
No, we don't.
Oh, well. In Toronto.
We could.
Home ground.
We have to rehearse it so we can remember it.
Okay, let's play then Alive.
Okay.
Alive.
By Pearl Jam.
By Pearl Jam. Mm-hmm. And Tad as well.
Yeah, hi, Eddie. And Tad as well.
Okay, on the Power 30.
We're going to play Jesus Christ Pose now, but I wanted to ask you how you feel about some of the negative viewer response we've had on it. I mean, we had one guy write in saying mm-hmm. that they felt you were mocking Jesus.
Well,
he's obviously very Christian, and yeah. you know, it insulted him in some way.
Well, you know, he's not part of our audience, and we're not writing songs for him. I mean, we have to be accountable to ourselves first and to the people who like us.
He was actually a metal fan, though.
Obviously, but not a Soundgarden fan, if that bothers him.
How did you mean for the song to be perceived?
Well, there's enough ambiguity in it that it allows for that kind of misinterpretation or other various interpretations. It's not mocking Jesus, though. It's not mocking Jesus. Why would we want to mock Jesus? You got a Christian church to do that for you. They can mock Jesus. But this had nothing to do with that. It was actually, the whole song was about people who exploit the crucifixion and Jesus's name and image for their own benefit. The commercialization of it, or the whole paranoid messianic martyr complex a lot of entertainers tend to come up with, you know, rock stars, movie actors, and also some television evangelists. So it was just a slap at those people. Now, I think anyone would be happy that we're slapping at someone who's like misrepresenting something that is dear to a lot of people's hearts.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
And it's a killer video, and I mean, whenever anybody sees it, it's just that they're glued to the TV set. But there's one other thing that just nobody's written to us about this. This is just coming from us.
Ooh.
Why did you pick the form of a female to be up on the cross? I mean, Jesus was a guy.
Yeah, that's probably one reason why we picked it. And more people are crucified than Jesus, a lot more people. I mean, it was the standard method of barbaric, you know, execution in those days. And I'm sure women and many other men were crucified. And you could have asked us why we put a salad on the cross, too. Little vegetable
nuts
guy.
And bolts.
Mr. Potato Head or whatever. Just to present the other visual images other than the traditional one.
Okay.
Which is a long-haired white guy with blue eyes. It's like, man, there's a lot of blue-eyed people in the Mideast, weren't there back then, North Africa. You know, it was Hitler who did that, who made Christ blue-eyed. You know that.
All right, Kim, thanks a lot. Really appreciate you coming on the show.
Hey, don't we get to introduce the Tad Stumbling Man video?
That was that last throw.
Okay.
I already played that one.
Oh, I already did. Never mind.
Why don't you introduce your own video?
Okay, this is a Jesus Christ pose. It's a real long video. I hope it doesn't hurt your feelings.
Ja, hi, ich bin der Deser und ich gebe heute mein Rockhard-Videodebüt und Mann, oh Mann, das findet gleich mit Soundgarden statt und das ist ziemlich super crunchy munchy. Neben uns sitzen Kim Tahil, Gitarrist von Soundgarden, und Ben Shepherd, hi. There is a new single out over here in Germany which features two Outshined Virgins and a cover of one of my favorite Devo songs and a cover of a Black Sabbath song. Is this the kind of melting pot Soundgarden comes from?
Yeah, I think we all have, we come from pretty much early, you know, punk rock roots and a lot of the post-punk music of the 80s, you know, Butthole Surfers, Big Black, Scratch Acid, and as well, we also like the guitar rock of the 60s and 70s, so it's a little bit of both, I mean.
Could you do me a favor and tell me something about the bad motor finger. Is this a bad motor finger? Is this a bad motor finger? Is this a bad motor finger? Or is this a bad motor finger? This one. So what's your favorite version of a bad motor finger?
I think it could be a spark plug in an engine.
Yeah,
or it could be a really bumpy highway. You know, a bad, you know, like the Autobahn had a bunch of holes in it. That'd be a bad motor finger.
But isn't there a new movement going on, this thing called Super Crunchy, Munchy, Vava, Distortion, Psycho Rifle, Terror, Electro Guitars thing, which is really different to the things Metallica are doing nowadays? Isn't there a new heaviness coming on?
Yeah, there probably is. I mean, if you're talking about
like Steppenwolf on a Badass and Trip mixed with MC5.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I talk about the bands in Seattle, and you look at Monster Magnet or
Detroit bands like Big Chief.
St. Vitus. Big Chief in Detroit. Right?
Yeah, surprise, surprise. As I promised you, in Seattle, I've got some St. Vitus CDs and Obsessed CDs with me. Those CDs you can't get in the States.
Wow.
May you open this big thing? You told me a story about St. Vitus that they wrote you to SST.
Well, they were very helpful. We had played a show with St. Vitus in Seattle, maybe, I don't know, 4 or 5 years ago. St. Vitus, Butthole Surfer, Soundgarden, and the U-Men. And St. Vitus were, I guess they said good things to us, about us, to Greg Ginn, and the guys from SST and Black Flag, as well as other bands. And they helped get us signed to SST. Our first shows we ever played in L.A., Wino came down to see.
Ja, das war das Soundgarden-Interview. Heute Abend kicken sie Ass mit COC im Tor 3. Wir gucken es uns auf jeden Fall an. Für all die, die nicht das Glück haben, diese durchweg ausverkauften Shows in Deutschland zu sehen, könnten sich ja Soundgarden im Vorprogramm von Guns N' Roses angucken. Die Tour ist für Herbst angesagt.
Yes, Headbangers Ball is coming to you from Birmingham, UK, and that video for Outshined heralds the arrival of tonight's very special guests all the way from Seattle. Soundgarden, Kim and Chris have joined me on Headbangers Ball, and welcome.
Thank you.
Now, you guys are winding up a European tour. How's that been working out for you?
Really awful, actually. it's been good. So all the shows have been sold out, and a lot of the fans seem to be really acquainted with our records, which is kind of different than the last few times we were here. Definitely different, but it's good.
Obviously, headlining is very different to what you were doing in the States, supporting Guns N' Roses in arenas, and we'll talk about that a little later on. And we've got lots of time to talk tonight because the band have joined me for pretty much the entire show, and I'd like to start really the obvious place, Seattle. Now, is there a Seattle sound, or do you think it's just that people are focusing their attention on the area because of bands like yourselves and Pearl Jam and Nirvana?
I think it's the second thing you said there.
Because Queensryche and War Babies and some of the other bands don't exactly fit into that.
No, not really.
Pearl Jam and Nirvana and Soundgarden don't really fit into any particular style of music either. They're different from each other. Mm-hmm. So it is primarily the region that's getting attention more than anything else.
Right. Now, one would assume that there is a lot of camaraderie between the bands in Seattle because obviously you teamed up with the band we now know as Pearl Jam for Temple of the Dog. And also, Chris, you actually contributed vocals to Alice in Chains' new EP, Sap. So do the bands kind of work together a lot and influence each other?
Well, it's all sort of a managerial type of thing, you know, we all completely hate each other, and, all these things are just arranged by, like, the Seattle kingpins and cigar-chomping people that just usher us around in limousines, and we sort of perform on each other's records.
They get us together during picnics and take photos and release them around. See, they are friends.
Yeah. I don't know why they insist on this unity thing. It's really getting tiring.
You can't see the chains and shackles on us while we're sitting there having soup and sandwiches with our best friends from Seattle.
Now, did you enjoy working with Eddie Vedder, Jeff Ament, and Sloane Gosard on the Temple of the Dog album? Did it kind of give you a chance to try a different creative approach, to the Soundgarden format?
Well,
Chris.
I don't know. I do a lot of things that don't necessarily fit into the regular Soundgarden format. That was just like one of the things that I've done. Mm-hmm. But as far as working with those guys as musicians, it was great.
Of course, you did it to pay tribute to your friend Andrew Wood, who died had the love bone. Did you find that therapeutic in kind of getting over his loss?
Well, I suppose we all had such a good time doing it, that there must have been a certain amount of like catharsis in it. But there was a couple songs really that were attributed to Andy, but. And that started the idea, but once the ball got rolling, the whole thing was really just the collaboration and just playing together as musicians. It wasn't like this writing a funeral piece or something.
Okay. Well, we're going to see the results of that collaboration because coming up now we've got the video from Temple of the Dog, and this is Hunger Strike. I'm still here with tonight's very special guests, Kim and Chris from Soundgarden. We'll be meeting new bassist Ben a little later on. But for now, guys, maybe you could talk about the Guns N' Roses tour in the States. You've been in arenas with them recently. What kind of challenges did that throw up for you? And kind of did you learn anything from it?
Well, we threw up a lot.
Yeah. That was challenging in and of itself.
I don't know if there was any particular challenge that we hadn't already been through. I mean, we've been in a lot of situations where we played in front of audiences that didn't know who we were. I think more than learning, you just sort of get used to the situation over a period of time without actually thinking about it. I mean, coming back and being on small stages does seem kind of weird sometimes when you wouldn't think that it would, because that's, you know, all we did for a number of years. So it's good to do both. I mean, we did that on that tour. We played our own shows and we'd play like 1,000 seat and then we'd play like a dome or something the next day. So the contrast was pretty strange.
I mean, how did you get on with Axl and co? Did you?
Just fine.
Yeah. Cool. I mean, did you see their decadent kind of lifestyle?
Those pigs.
In complete opposition to your own kind of low-key philosophy.
Oh, I don't think they're particularly any more decadent than what would sell a magazine piece, or what would sell a video piece.
But the whole, it's such a such a big setup, isn't it? Loads of security and loads of people,
I suppose,
backstage.
Same at a soccer game, right? Soccer match. I suppose you could be backstage with Soundgarden and decide that it was decadent.
We're awful pigs.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you judge success? Is it a good gig?
By the size of the deli tray you get backstage.
Right.
Like, you call this cheese? That kind of thing.
No, seriously. I mean, it's not. I guess for you guys, it's not album sales, is it? It's.
Well, I guess that would be one barometer of success.
Even if you're doing what you want to do and you love it, and nobody else likes it at all, you know, it's sort of hard to consider it successful by like any normal standards.
Has anything surprised you about your success so far?
That we had some success.
Yeah, that is surprising.
That in itself was a surprise.
Because our records aren't, obvious commercial records with obvious singles and, you know, radio hits.
You can't dance to Soundgarden songs, and you're not likely to go shopping with your girlfriends while listening to Soundgarden material, so.
You can dance to Soundgarden songs, but it's embarrassing.
I don't agree with
you there. You look silly.
Well, it's kind of like playing
I go shopping with my husband listening to Soundgarden records.
You know, we're not like an obviously commercial band, but there's a lot of bands over a period of time that have more success than commercial bands just because, you know, what they're doing is outside the norm and it's what they want to do, which is pretty easy to, at some point, tell if a band that you're into is like doing something they want to do or doing something for some other reason.
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah. Well, we'll talk more about Bad Motorfinger later on. We've got plenty of time to talk. But right now we're going to see a band making their debut on Headbangers Ball. They come from New York. They're called White Zombie. I don't know if you've heard of these
guys. They're a cool band. We played with them before.
Yeah?
They've been around for a little while.
Yeah, they have. They've got their debut album out on the Geffen label called La Sexorcisto Devil Music Volume 1. And this is the first single, Thunderkiss 65. And check out those dreadlocks. New York band White Zombie making their debut on Headbangers Ball. And we're back now with the stars of tonight's show, Soundgarden. And Kim is still with me, but now I've been joined by new bass player, Ben. Hi, Ben. Welcome to MTV. Now, actually, I've got a question for Kim first, and this is a viewer's question sent in by Kate O'Malley from Ireland. She'd like to know why both previous bassists, Hiro Yamamoto and Jason Everman, left the band.
Hiro left on his own free will. He'd been in the band for 5 years, and I think he wanted to pursue other interests. Mm-hmm. He's gone back to school, and he's studying chemistry. Mm-hmm. And then, the way I see it, we pretty much met two bass players. You know, we had Hiro, and he played on the records up until then, and then Ben's on the new record. In the interim, we had a bass player, Jason, who was with us for 6 months, and I think things weren't working out. I think when Hiro left, it was a definite big hole in the band, and it would have been a lot of pressure for anyone to fill the shoes at that point in time, and it wasn't working out. We figured that Ben
Ben's personality and creativity and attitude was far more of what we're looking for, what was appropriate for Soundgarden at the time.
What did you think was so special about Ben that he was going to fit into Soundgarden?
It had a lot to do with the creativity, the insight. His talents are beyond just being a musician. I mean, it's good to draw from other influences, whether it's film or writing, or mm-hmm. it's good to have a person who has an insight into social issues and artistic and aesthetic issues. Mm-hmm. You know, to begin with, you need to be a person who's interesting, I think, in order to make interesting music. Mm-hmm.
Ben, I've got a question for you as well. The song Somewhere, which you contributed to Bad Motorfinger, did you write that before you were in the band, or did you write it especially for Soundgarden?
Well, the lyrics were jumbled and written, I think, before I was in the band. Mm-hmm. But I'm not sure, because they're all jumbled up in this book. Mm-hmm. And the music I wrote while I was in the band.
And Jesus Christ Pose is—we're actually going to talk about that song later on. But just preliminarily, that was the only song on the album where all four members were credited. Now, is that a trend for kind of songwriting in the future?
For us,
yeah.
Or for other bands, it might be a trend for other bands in the future.
No, it's pretty standard for us to make up songs out of a jam. Yeah. That's where that song comes from.
Right. Okay. Well, right now we've got our first commercial break coming up. But before that, we're going to check out Soundgarden live on stage here at the Institute in Birmingham. But
okay, I'm going to go down and get my guitar.
But please stick around because the Headbangers Ball will continue with more from Soundgarden a little bit later on. Hi, welcome back to Headbangers Ball, coming to you from the Institute in Birmingham with special guests Soundgarden. And Kim and Chris are back with me on the show. And in fact, we met Ben a little earlier. We won't actually be meeting up with Matt, the drummer, because unfortunately he's not too well. Nothing serious, I hear.
No, he's just got a little boo-boo. Nothing a Band-Aid can't help.
Boo-boo? What's that?
He fell down with boom.
Oh, right. Now we're going to concentrate on your lyrics for the next few minutes. And seems that you kind of have the ethic that less is more. And when I was talking to Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam, he said that one of the most satisfying aspects of Pearl Jam was hearing other people's interpretations of his songs, what they thought the songs mm-hmm. meant. Yeah. Is that the same for you guys?
Well, I don't tend to really want to listen to other people's interpretations of them. I want other people to have interpretations of them, as long as they don't talk to me about them. So,
well, is that not sort of useful feedback?
Well, no. I don't think of lyric writing in terms of feedback or, you know, drawing ideas about what I do from somebody else. I think it just comes from me, you know. I don't want to say I don't care what somebody else thinks or how they feel about my lyrics. I just don't think it has anything to do with my lyrics, that's all.
Now, where does your inspiration come from? Is it from kind of reading books or personal experience or TV or?
It could be from any of those things. It could mm-hmm. be from like something I'm reading or something somebody says or something I see on television, or just like none of the above, where I'm just like walking around, all of a sudden an idea just pops into my head. Mm-hmm. It's similar to music, I guess, in that, you know, you sort of will draw from anything that inspires you to write music as well as lyrics.
We're not really artists, we're actually vessels and agents of the fourth dimension, where this world consists entirely of lyrics and music, and we're just a conductor for that.
Or a funnel, maybe. Yeah.
Okay. If I could highlight the song New Damage, is that a comment about America or the world in general?
The world in general.
Yeah, okay. And Holy Water. Is that about religion in particular, or is the message that people should not be dictated to and should make up their own minds how to live?
Yeah, the latter of what you just said is pretty much, that could pretty much sum that song up, really. It's a message that way, or if you want to take it as a personal thing, you know, feeling that way. When someone's ideas, they'll try to put on my shoulders.
And Kim, you made your debut as a lyricist on Room a Thousand Years Wide. You've heard this all before. Was the music the inspiration for that
yeah,
song?
Definitely.
Or was it vice versa?
Yeah, it was the music.
Because Matt wrote the music in
yeah,
that instance, didn't he?
I liked it quite a bit, so I wanted to come up with lyrics for it.
There's kind of a religious connotation to that.
Well, that's really
song.
Funny. You were talking about lyrics earlier and how people interpret them. We had some people coming up and saying, Room a Thousand Years Wide, that's about Satan, isn't it? And I said, Then you have other people come up and go, Room a Thousand Years Wide, that's about Jesus, isn't it? I said, well, yeah, okay. Jesus, Satan, it's about that. Maybe other people come up and say, it's about Jesus and Satan, right? The left and the right hand.
And Kim would say, his typical response is, well, you're so vain, I bet you think this song is about you.
Well, I think we should let the listeners of the album make up their own minds on that one. Okay, we've got some more music on the way. I don't know if you've heard of this band called Antidote New York City. They're making their debut on Headbangers Ball, another brand new video for you. These guys come from New York. They have a debut album out on April the 13th called Viva Los Pendejos. And this is the first single, and it's called Return to Burn. That was Antidote New York City making their debut on Headbangers Ball, another cool band mixing lots of different influences, as I'm sure you realised from that video. And right now, Kim and Ben are back with me on the Headbangers Ball from Birmingham, Soundgarden special. And I guess a good question to involve Ben with. This album seems to be a lot more diverse in terms of the style of the various different songs. To what do you attribute that new diversity? Do you think Ben's brought some influences there?
Oh, I thought you were asking Ben this question.
Well, both of you. I'd like to know what you both.
Yeah, I think a lot of it has to do with having a fourth songwriter, mm-hmm. a contributor.
What are your influences, Ben?
From Johnny Cash to Charles Mingus to Killing Joke to SPK, whatever.
Very diverse. Do you think that you guys took any risks on Bad Motor Finger?
No, we played it pretty safe. We were kind of, we thought, look, you guys, we better not try that. They won't play it. No, I don't think we had to consciously take any risks. It just, we write songs, and if we like the song, we'll play it, or we'll record it. Mm-hmm. So, okay. I don't think there's, just do what you do.
Do you find that your anger comes out in your music? Anger about the state of the world?
Yeah, I'd say so. Because we don't run around hitting people very often, so I think the music is the best way to express that.
Mm-hmm. But something that I feel is possibly overlooked a lot with Soundgarden is your sense of humor. Does that annoy you that people often overlook that aspect? They think you're so serious
Well, sometimes it's more annoying if people focus on it like, oh, well, Soundgarden, they're kind of a tongue-in-cheek bunch of guys. It's like, I think it's just a way to offset the anger and the hostility, you know? Mm-hmm. Because it's just a way, I mean, you can be the kind of person you are, then when you have to live in a world, have relationships with people like yourself or press or record company or fans.
Okay, well, thanks very much for that. And we've got another commercial break coming up. We're going to see some more from Soundgarden live in just a moment. But please stay tuned, because after the break, I'll be meeting up with Soundgarden support band Corrosion of Conformity.
Yay!
Yeah. Hi, welcome back to Headbangers Ball, coming to you from the Institute in Birmingham. Just before the break there, you saw COC live on stage here at this venue. And right now, I'm back with the stars of tonight's show, and that is Soundgarden, and Kim and Chris are still here. And we've got the video for Jesus Christ Pose coming up in a little while, and I'd like to sort of focus on that song, very interesting song. Now, some people may think it's a song about religion, which I don't believe it is. Is it more accusing society of using an image to kind of get a point across?
Yeah, that is it.
It is.
Is it?
Yeah. More or less.
But I also felt there was an element of maybe saying, don't preach at me when you're kind of not perfect yourself.
Well, no, not really. I mean, it's just sort of being annoyed with people using that symbol for their own personal vanity or
gain, exploiting it.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. I guess in the States, it's kind of different because over in Europe we don't have those kind of television preachers.
Well, it's not just that. I mean, you do have entertainers and you have pop stars and movie actors.
So it could refer to any of them.
Yeah, the idea didn't come from televangelists or religious organizations. I mean, it came from seeing models, fashion models, and like pop stars doing that pose or doing videos where they're tied to the cross or whatever, you know. Putting themselves in like the persecuted deity situation. Mm-hmm. I just saw a lot of it over a period of a few months, and that's where the idea from the song came from.
Right.
So it isn't really religious at all.
It's perhaps one of the least accessible tracks on the album. Why did you choose it as the first single here in the UK?
Because it has a good beat.
And you can dance
to it.
And you can go shopping to it.
It's very colorful. The song is definitely.
I think as a song, it's fairly definitive of Soundgarden, at least a particular side of us.
Mm-hmm. Right. And the video has a kind of very kind of avant-garde art feel, as you'll see in a moment. Do you enjoy making videos, or do you feel that that's an area that's kind of out of your control to some degree?
Well, it is, I think, out of everyone's control to a degree, as far as getting exactly what you want. But I think making a record can be that way too. It's just a lot more difficult because you have a lot less time than you have when you make a record.
Right.
From actually meeting the director and discussing the ideas and the techniques and then actually shooting the video, you know, which can be a day or two.
Right.
And then editing, you know, you might see two or three different edits. It's like you have an idea of what the kind of record you want to make before you make it, and then actually making that record is a lot more likely than having an idea for a video and actually making the video that you want.
But you were pretty happy with the realization of this one?
Yeah, definitely.
Looking back over your career now, when you listen to your albums and think about them, would you say that they're kind of biographical, this is how I was then, this is how I am now kind of?
Well, they're classics.
They stand the test of time, really.
When you listen to that album, you don't think, well, that's how I felt when I wrote that song.
Well, I think you always do. You know, you remember where you were when you wrote it and what you were thinking or how you felt or what you were wearing or where you lived or whatever.
No, but, I mean,
definitely,
you know,
you're
maturing as people as well, I'm sure. You know?
Yeah, there's things I think you could consider, like, progressing and things you could consider, like, digressing, I guess, either way.
Okay. And just very quickly, we're reaching the end of our interview here. You've got European arena shows coming up with Guns N' Roses. Are you mm-hmm. looking forward to those?
Yeah, definitely. It's really exciting.
Okay.
As well as Faith No More, I think.
Yeah, they're
yes.
on the bill as well.
That's gonna be
we haven't seen fun. Those guys in a while either.
Okay.
It's quite a bit of fun.
All right. Well, thanks for that for now. And we're going to see Soundgarden. Get it right, Vanessa. Soundgarden live on stage here at Birmingham again. Coming up very shortly, and then after the break, the guys will be back to choose the metal collection. So I'm sure you'll be interested to see which videos they've chosen. But for now, here they are live. Hi, and welcome back to the Headbangers Ball, coming to you from Birmingham with special guest Soundgarden. And we finished the interviews now, really. And all that remains is the metal collection, which you guys don't know, but here in Europe, this is the part of the show where we play What Do You Say. Normally it's chosen by a viewer, but tonight we're going to ask you to choose the videos to play out the rest of the show. So if you could give us your video choice and why you've chosen these particular tracks.
See, I think the first video I'd like to see is Motorhead's Angel City.
Featuring the Cycle Sluts from Hell. Cool.
How about Mother Love Bone.
Mm-hmm. And that's a track called Star Dog mm-hmm. Champion.
And then I think I'd like to see Voivod, I think.
Okay. Excellent. Clouds in My House from
the
new
Voivod
album.
Angel
yeah. Rat. Cool album. And we're going to kick off the proceedings with
Prong, because they're heavy and
it was all we could think of, right?
They're good looking and. But really, why did you want to see the Voivod video?
Because it was off the top of my head, right there.
Okay.
I remembered it.
Okay, so actually Prong are going to be guests on Headbangers Ball in the not too distant future, hopefully. And here they are with their newest video, and this is the title track of their current album, Prove You Wrong. That was the Metal Collection, as chosen for you by tonight's very special guests, Soundgarden. And if you'd like to take part in the Metal Collection, send your four favourite videos of all time to the usual Headbangers Ball address. And we're really, really reaching the end of our show now. And all that remains is for me to say thank you very much for joining me here on Headbangers Ball. And it's been a great pleasure talking to you.
Yeah, it was fun being here.
Best of luck with everything, and thank you very much.
Thanks.
I'm Chris.
I'm Kim.
We're Soundgarden, and you're watching
Raw Power.
The first time we came over here, we were touring to support our first LP, which was, we had had two previous EPs before that, and then 3 years of being a band before that. So, you know, we've been a band for a long time, and I think a lot of, like, the developmental stage you're talking about, as far as being fresh and just, you know, figuring out what you want to do and who you are, we did before we ever even made a record.
During the Guns N' Roses tour, yeah, perhaps a little bit, because I think people, a lot of people wanted to do interviews with us to find out about Guns N' Roses, and our audience grew pretty quickly, and the press, the circle of people we had a working relationship with keeps growing, and pieces are moved, new pieces are added. And with the Guns N' Roses tour, the circle was really huge, larger as far as who wanted to deal with you and who wanted a piece of you. And you don't have any time to develop these relationships or even maintain them or anything. So that could be a little bit quick. You got half the people you don't even want in your circle. You don't even want to deal with them, but they're there. Well, people always want to know about Seattle, but there's just like I said, the circle's grown. People that we used to have, you know, a decent working relationship with, you now have these little shadows around every corner that want to know about Nirvana and Pearl Jam and Seattle and Soundgarden and Sub Pop, and it's different talking to the Village Voice or the LA Times or some underground magazine like, you know, Your Flesh or whatever, and then turning around and having to talk to USA Today or Entertainment Tonight or Time Magazine. We can have exciting, great interviews, and then we can have interviews where people go away saying, Soundgarden are a bunch of dicks, or all they would say is yes, no, or they were hostile. It varies, just like it, you know, it's like people you deal with, you know, in the real world.
When you first make a record, it's pretty impossible to tell if it's good or not, or even what it is, or have any idea about it at all. But after a few months, you know, away from the studio, and, you know, going back and listening to it and playing the songs, it's pretty easy to tell whether or not it's good, or whether or not it's, you know, something that we can be proud of, and we definitely feel proud of it.
So where are you taking me now?
Well, we're actually through taking you anywhere. We've shown you Seattle.
Seattle's a nice place.
It is. So shut the door when you leave.
is this goodbye?
Yeah, it is. I'm sorry. We're home now.
All right. And, I'll see you later.
We'll call
you.
Thank you. Sometime. Bye.
You gotta do some laundry.
Wipe your feet before you.
Sorry.
It's all right.
Soundgarden.
Yeah.